North Middletown Christian Church. We are glad that you are able to worship with us, whether you're here in this space or worshiping from home. We welcome you in the name and the love of Jesus Christ our Lord. And so now, as Doug plays the prelude, and as the light of Christ comes into our presence, we are reminded that Christ is with us always. And this is our opportunity to draw our hearts closer to Him and to one another. Let us worship the Lord today.
Thank you. Join, please, in our invocation.
O Lord, our Creator and Sustainer, you give us seasons to plant, to grow, to harvest, and to rest, and we are grateful. As the leaves turn and fall from the trees, help us embrace the changes we see as a natural part of life. We come today with our ups and downs, doubts and fears, trials and triumphs. We're grateful you have created each one of us and molded us into your own image. As we worship you, help us stand strong and sure where the winds blow.
Celebrate them as an important part of the church. And so I know our church is not big in numbers, but we do have an important role to play when it comes to children. And Ann Fuller's going to do that in just a little bit. She's going to take Lucas over to the Worship and Wonder area, share story, prayer, talk. That's fine. And I want us to remember our role in raising the next generation, because it's very important that we transmit the faith to all who are in our midst, especially the children. And I bet that the more we interact with them, the more we'll learn from them. They have a lot to teach us about the love of God. And so thank you for coming forward today. And thank you for being with us and being a good lesson for us. Amen. Thank you, baby. Good job. Uh-oh, we dropped something.
Thank you.
I'll take any chance I get to hold a baby. It's like, forgive me. Well, we have already gone through our church's prayer list, and we have shared some joys and concerns before the service began. So if you're worshiping from home and you have access to your newsletter, please take a moment now to review that so that we can go to God with all of these names and these various situations on our hearts and our minds. We continue to pray for our neighbors in Florida and Puerto Rico, who are still recovering. They're going to be in a long phase of recovery from the hurricanes. And we know that there are many congregations that have sustained damage, and certainly disciples in their homes are recovering from all the damage of the hurricane. And so I just remind you that Week of Compassion is always available if you would like to make a donation. And probably when you click where you want it to go, there's probably one that says hurricane relief. But if not, you can put where most needed, and you can also identify your church if you would like to have that tracked through our congregation. I want to just go ahead and give us a moment of silence as we can approach God with our own prayers and listen to what God has to say to us. And then I will pray on the church's behalf, and we will close with the Lord's Prayer. Let us pray. Most holy and gracious God, we give you thanks. Thanks for this day. Thank you to be alive so that we might enjoy it. We're grateful to be able to gather in the house of the Lord. And even for those who cannot be with us here in your sanctuary, we know that you make us one as the body of Christ. Therefore, it does not matter where we worship, as long as we come together in spirit. We thank you for the beauty of this day and in this special place we inhabit. We pray, God, that we can take a lesson from the changing of the leaves of these beautiful trees around us, that for everything there is a season and a time for every purpose under heaven. So like the leaves on the trees, let us not be resistant to change, but accept what you have in store for us, even if it feels like a part of us is dying. You still have a plan that we, like the earth, can be replenished and renewed. And so, God, we pray for those who are on our church's prayer list, the names and situations of people we know. You know that they are on our hearts. And so, God, help them feel your healing and comfort. And may they accept your will for their lives. We pray for our family members, members of our community, especially those who are traveling for fall break. We pray for our children, those that we've celebrated in our midst, but we know that there are many more, God. They are in need of love in their homes, for shelter, food, and guidance. And so, Holy God, help us as your people minister in the situations that are before us. Open our eyes to the needs of the world, so that when we encounter someone in need, we see them as your beloved child, made perfectly in your divine image, and that we are moved with compassion to minister unto them in the same beautiful way that our Lord ministered while he was here on earth. So strengthen your church, O God. Strengthen your universal church in every place on this planet, but also strengthen this congregation. Remind us that we are not a small church, for there are no small churches in the kingdom of God, and yet the gospel continues to uplift that which is small. Mustard seeds, children in small places. We have a unique ability to spread the gospel in our neighborhood and community. And so by our worship today, God, don't just comfort us, no, challenge us. May we not pray for easy lives, but lives that are effective in the bringing of your kingdom here on earth. And so we pray this in the holy name of Jesus, who taught us how to minister, who showed us how to love, and who teaches us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading today is from Luke 17, the 17th chapter, verses 11 to 19. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. He was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." A word from the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Your faith has made you well. My, my, my. If our wellness depended on our faith, how well would we be, I wonder? Have you noticed lately that there's this resurgence of the word well and wellness? I think it's just a ploy to get me to spend more money in CVS. They have the wellness section, and then I can come out with that huge long receipt. One day, I'm going to come in here and wear one as a stole. They're that long for your CVS receipts. So wellness now is this term that's used where once before we might have said the word health. And it seems to me that the way we're using this word, wellness is a bit more encompassing of all the areas of health, not just physical health. So it might include our mental health, our emotional and spiritual health, whereas health used to just imply the physical realm. For one's health checkups, she might need to go see her medical doctors, have her blood work done, and any necessary tests conducted. But if there is stress, anxiety, depression, one should see a mental health practitioner. But wellness even incorporates more. It might include meditation, relaxation, going to get a therapeutic massage. It might include someone talking to you about your nutritional habits and your exercise. Your wellness might be improved by going for a walk in nature or eating a delicious meal with people you love and sharing good conversation. And so as your pastor, I want you to take care of your health, but also your wellness. And so this story has 3 major patterns to it, and I want you to pay attention to it. First, there's healing, then there's praising, and then there's thanking. Healing, praising, thanking. And I suggest to you that we have much to learn about these 3 things, and this story perfectly encapsulates it. When we are healed, do we turn around and give praise and thanks to God when it happens? That's a good question. So let's look at those 3 things in the order that they occur. First, there's the healing. Notice that gratitude was not a prerequisite for healing, nor was praise, nor was faith. Jesus readily healed all 10 of them. All of them were deemed clean from a medical perspective. Now, those of us, we've lived through a terrible few years of pandemic, and so we are aware of the social implications of being sick. When you are sick, people don't want you around.
We used to be more polite about it, and we would just endure your sniffling and coughing and all that, but no more. We're done with that. If you got the cuties, stay at home. And so now, have you noticed how very apologetic and overly explanatory people are when they have a sniffle or a sneeze in public, lest someone think that they are bringing the virus into their midst? We say, no, it's just my allergies. My allergies are acting up. And I promise you, just yesterday at the regional assembly in Tennessee that I attended, a woman coughed and quickly explained to everybody, I got this post-nasal drip and it makes me cough. And so now we're giving everybody our medical biography, autobiographies, to just explain why we might have a sniffle or a sneeze or a cough. And so you need to be ready with your explanation should that happen to you in the public. You know, whip out your card and your explanation. And so this scripture definitely has components of physical healing, and that should underscore for us that healing in the ancient world, as well as ours, has social implications, especially for those suffering with leprosy. They didn't understand it. They didn't understand what it was or how it could be spread. And so what they did with people who had various types of skin diseases that this covers, they would just take them outside the city. Basically, they would quarantine them outside the community so that they could not spread this disease. And they had to go to the priest, not a medical doctor, a priest, to show that they were in a state of health before they could be allowed back into the community. And so these 9 former lepers, they actually do exactly what Jesus says. He says, go show yourself. And so they do. They run, they take off. But there is this one, and he dares to disobey Jesus. He turns back. So let's pay attention to that. Haven't we noticed in the biblical narrative the significance of turning back? You recall in Matthew's gospel, the Magi, after being warned about Herod, returned home by a different route. They changed direction. And remember Saul, he was on his path down the road to Damascus when he was struck blind and the voice of God spoke to him, or Jesus. And that changed the direction of his life. And so it's a lot like repentance. That's how we describe repentance. It requires a change of mind, a change of heart, and a change of direction. And so we might do well to pay attention to the Samaritan who turned back. He changed direction. We should also pay attention to the way Luke refers to him. It's not just a man. It's not just one of the 10 lepers. He dedicates a sentence to this man. And this is what it is. It says, and he was a Samaritan. There is existing animosity between the Jews of Judea and the Jews of Samaria. And that's where Jesus was between. He was on his way to Samaria. There's a long history to it. And so I'm just going to boil it down to a few of the essentials. And that is, it had to do with who they believed was ethnically pure and Jewish, and who had the correct place of worship. And so we will remember that the Jews were dispersed around the Middle East when the Babylonians took captivity of Judea. And so some Jews living abroad for a couple of generations, it would be natural that they would start to intermarry with the people who lived around them. And some of them began worshiping at other sites because the temple was destroyed. But when the Persians conquered the Babylonians and King Cyrus allowed the Jews to return, suddenly there were some issues about who could come back. Who were the real Jews that could occupy Jerusalem and Judea? And when they began that rebuilding process, they started some tribal infighting of who were the right ones that were allowed to claim the land, the heritage, and the place of worship. So throughout this gospel and the book of Acts, also written by Luke, He is making radical claims that those who have not been considered inside the pure Jewish faith, these Samaritans, they are part of the kingdom of God. It was clear in the story that we heard about the Samaritan who stopped to help the man lying in the ditch after he had been ignored by two other Jews. And it's clear in this story, even Samaritans are worthy of healing. And at least this one has his faith uplifted by Jesus. So on the topic of faith, why are we told that the faith of this man has healed him, when he was surely just as clean as the others? We have no mention of the faith of others. We don't know if they're Jews, Samaritans, Gentiles, or whatever, but we know that they are also healed. So what is the difference between this man and the others? And so that takes us to the second part. We've covered the healing. Let's go to the praising. It's an interesting point in this text that the word for praise comes from the Greek doxon, which is the same root word as doxology, which we sing every week. Our service. And so when something amazing happens in your life, like if you are healed, do you stop, turn from what you are doing, and offer praise to God? In this case, it was a physical healing that God is being praised for, but in our lives, it might be some other type of healing. It really doesn't matter what the circumstance is, if it's great or small. Do we remember what the old 100th says? Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Given the doxology, is it even possible to separate faith from praise? Many theologians say it is not possible. Karl Barth says the most natural response to God is not fear and trembling, not guilt and dread, but gratitude. And C.S. Lewis observed the connection between gratitude and personal well-being. There's that word again, wellness. He says, I noticed how the humblest and at the same time the most balanced minds praised most, while the cranks, the misfits, and the malcontents praised least. Praise almost seems to be inner health made audible. Ain't that the truth? Have you ever been around someone who's just grumpy and a complainer? You want to avoid them at the same rate that you want to avoid the virus. It's like at all costs. You just wonder how miserable they must be internally to be that unpleasant externally. Now, they might be healthy, but I can tell you they ain't well. So the Samaritan demonstrates a faith that is complete because it includes thankfulness. His healing goes beyond the physical or medical realm. It enters the spiritual. It's fine to be free from leprosy and included in the community, but it's a different thing altogether to be aware of what has been done and to be grateful for it. He has been made healthy, but he has also been made well. And just to complicate issues a little further, the word that is translated in our scriptures as well can also be saved. So hear it this way: your faith has saved you. You've often heard me say that salvation is every bit as much about what happens on this side of heaven as it is what happens when we die. The wonderful thing about salvation is you can actually be aware that you are in a state of being redeemed, and then that changes how you live, not how you die. And every day, aware of our salvation, we can choose to live into it. It is like this man's awareness of what has happened makes him live into his faith in a way that the other nine did not bother to notice. Jesus healed him, but his faith has made him whole. It's not lost on us disciples that the word used for the Samaritan's thanksgiving is the Greek word eucharisto, from which we get the word Eucharist, which we call communion. We can gather around the table each week. We can eat the bread, drink the wine, recite the words, and then we can walk out of here and just return to how we were living before. We can just be grumpy old men and women, just be complaining and malcontent. Or we can come to this table aware that our healing has already begun by what Christ has done for us. And in our gratitude, not just in our eating and drinking, we are changed. In a way, this meal reminds us of our salvation being worked out by Christ on our behalf. It doesn't depend on us to happen, but our willingness to it, our openness to it, helps make us aware of it. And for that, we should be grateful. And so now we've covered all three: healing, praising, thanking. Once again, let us notice that it's not praising and thanking that comes first. It's healing. And that order is important because Jesus healed first. He healed anyway, even for the nine that wouldn't turn around and show thankful praise. So it's not dependent on our thankful praise. We will be healed anyway. But I suggest to you that this order of healing, praising, and thanking is a threefold way, a model to live our lives. Aware of how you have already been healed, or if you would like to hear the word saved, do you indeed turn around, praise God, and thank the healer of your life? Our Lord is our healer. Our faith, however, makes us well. Thanks be to God. And now, as we turn our attention to this table of gratitude, I want you to hear some words that are recited in other traditions as they approach the table. The words are, "Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. Eternal God, holy and mighty, it is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise and to worship you in every place where your glory abides." This is recited by churches, usually by the priest presiding at the table, and it is called the Great Thanksgiving. See, we tend to think of Thanksgiving as the part that happens after the table, where we are invited to give thanks to God and to offer our gifts to God. But let's back it up a little earlier in our service. The Great Thanksgiving starts here at the table. And so today, as we approach this table and receive the nutrition that we need for our spiritual well-being, let us be made aware of what is already being made known to us in our lives, and that we are just simply reminded of it by these elements at the table. And for all of this, let us approach it with gratitude. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise. Let us prepare ourselves to receive this holy meal.
Oh,
is always with us, for we are never alone. You are our Lord, and you are shadowing us always. You are not an absent God, an inert God. Our precious Jesus gave his life that we may have endless life. And that is why we are at this table. This is our reminder, and we give thanks and praise. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Once again, welcome. If you have not already done so, please take a moment now to fill out your welcome card. And on the back of it, list your doxon, or your doxology, or your praise and thanksgiving. Therefore, if this is not your week to make a monetary gift to the church, you are still participating in this important act of worship that we call offering or thanksgiving or doxology. I also want to point out to you, I'm a 49-year-old woman and I shouldn't be this proud, but I have created some QR codes that you can scan with the camera of your phone. And it brings up a little yellow text. And if you tap on it, it should either take you to our church's main website or straight to Givelify, which is the system that is set up by our denomination so that churches can utilize online giving. I am so grateful for opportunities like this to give when I don't have cash readily available. And I'm one of the people in life that I'm no longer carrying around checks. I only write a few checks a month, if that. And so this is kind of a new way of doing things, and it only gets 100% of the donations that would not have been made otherwise. So I'm going to be working on some more things like this. So also remember that if you have volunteered any hours for the church, outside the church, at work, in the community, also list that on your card. We are counting what matters, and I think that matters. It's an indication that we are living into our calling as disciples. So with joyful, grateful, and generous hearts, let us give to the Lord. Fellowship. The confession is simple. Jesus is Lord. Let us sing our hymn of departing, number 5, O For a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Go forth into the world in peace. Amen.
Amen. Amen.